So once again, I was trying this in just before the Wirecast crash, which meant the Facebook Live crashed. All of you folks watching on Facebook Live, do whatever that sharing thing is that the kids do. Tweet your friends. Instagram. What are some other?
I should use Instagram. I barely ever Instagram, but yeah. I mean, even Snapchat it.
Yeah, I'll Snapchat you guys right and now. And Vine. No, Vine is gone.
No, I think they're
put it on MySpace.
No, MySpace.
Not MySpace.
I draw Marty my. Live I think I draw my line there. You can't find your ICOM hat, right, Marty?
My only ICOM hat. I think I had like ICOM hat A, B, C, spare C, D.
All right. So this sounds like a pregnant pause, and it's maybe time to start a show.
Yeah. Yep. I'd like to see your video first, Gary.
Snapchatting.
Oh, am I not sending video? I guess
no, and it's really hard to talk to you when I can't see you.
Ah. Call? Share screen.
So here's the question. If we don't know whose show it is, who starts the show?
I'll tell you in just a second. Because I'm busy trying to get things full screen here.
Trying to pretend he knows what he's doing.
Trying to get things full screen here. This is Ham Radio Now, episode 293. The Phasing Line Mashup. Are you guys going to... Is that okay? Is that,
no, can we give... And we need to give our...
And this is the Phasing Line episode 7?
No, this is the Phasing Line podcast episode number 8.
Oh.
What? Because he snuck one in on you when you were out of town.
Oh, man.
Yeah. And I have a couple already in edit.
Oh, okay. But this is going to go in first?
When will this go? Well, when are you going to have this edited, Gary?
I'll get it on tonight.
I mean, it's already live.
No, so
it's
you said that about Dayton. You still have stuff from a year ago.
I do.
Sounds like me.
I've got you, actually.
You got me?
Yeah. We were in the stands and recorded something,
the content is inappropriate for airing, but
it's fine.
It was a very cool location.
It's fine. So on the video screen here... are from left to right, my co-host, David Goldenberg, W0DHG. David, welcome to whatever this is.
Yes, whatever the mashup is. And I told you at the end, I'll tell you what I think.
Yeah.
Whose show it should be.
Which show this is.
We're taking you, David.
Here in the middle is the chicken with fries.
Yeah, Marty, KC1CWF. Good to be here.
And there on the right... For the very first time, his very first appearance on Ham Radio Now, and not his first appearance on the Phasing Line podcast.
Indeed.
Sterling Coffey.
Hello, N0SSC. I'm glad to be here.
And for those of you who are listening to the Phasing Line, I'm Gary Pearce, KN4AQ, the other host of the Ham Radio Now show. I have a beef bone to pick with you guys. You have mentioned on your show every other Ham Radio podcast out there.
See,
but mine.
We have a secret here, Gary.
We don't tell them about the good ones because then they'll listen to the good ones and not ours.
Just talk about your show.
I just slammed a lot of podcasts
scenes.
in the process.
Yeah, you did. Every other one.
Every other one.
And so
now we just talk to you behind the scenes.
So that being said, I'll make the following admission: the only reason I wanted to do this mashup, other than I think it will be a lot of fun, is I want your audience.
And we want yours.
You've been on the air for 7 podcasts, and you already have a bigger audience than I do.
Do we? I know our first episode got like, I don't know, 2,000, our first couple episodes got
our
like
first 2,000. Our first episode got like 2,000 downloads.
Yeah.
Oh, and then what happened?
And then we started Patreon, and they started giving us money, so we kept going.
Yeah.
And I think it's interesting, not to go down a tangent, but how some people start new products with user bases, or followers, whatever you want to call them, and then they kind of grasp onto that, and sometimes people don't, and as their content develops, their audience reaches out. So we kind of had the good fortune of I'm active in the ham radio internets, interwebs, radio webs.
They're both famous.
Sterling is too.
Famous. I wouldn't go so far to say famous, but yeah, I've been in it too. I've had a YouTube channel. I'm on Twitter, and I try to put myself out
Reddit.
There quite a bit. I did writing with the ARL for a long time.
I was going to say, you're some kind of an ARL youth editor. At least you were.
I was. Yeah, I was.
What did that mean?
They were It was, I did a web column. It was basically 1,000 words on whatever topic I wanted for each month. And I don't know, it didn't get, I don't know if how many actual like views and like impressions it got, but I also did a few things and like book reports. I did a few articles and I'm getting back into it. I did one on Hamlog, a iOS app for logging and a couple other things. So yeah. And I have a lot of friends at the AWRL from that. Ward Silver being like one of my first friends. So knowing him,
he lives nearby.
Yeah. He lives just about 10, well, I guess 30 minutes away from here. Which I didn't know until one day I got a message from him saying, hey, you want to go to Dayton? And this was in like 2010. And we drove 6 hours to Dayton. And from that point on, and it all happened. It all started because I went to his school. W0EEE is Missouri S&T, and it was formerly UMR. And that's where he got his W degree from. So hopefully I'll follow in his footsteps and, you know, bring a lot of cool stuff. Like ham radio 2.0 or 3.0 or 8.0 or whatever is going on.
I caught that 8.0.
Yeah, because apparently you watched. I've been watching a lot of new developments in the hobby too. I try to keep aware of news. I haven't been doing hardly any operating. I have
you my do a lot of radio, not a lot of radio.
Yeah, I'm mainly a public figure. I try to be and. I did Napota last year. I did some contests. Sweepstakes is always my favorite. But
I feel like it's more for contests.
Yeah, exactly. For the most part, I live in an apartment, so I don't have like a shack I can just pop into. So I do a lot of remote web SDR stuff. So, but I have fun. But that's what I want to do is be kind of a public figure to be more interesting to the young people and youth. And
now, you and Marty, do you want to be the voice of youth in ham radio? Because Marty,
no, not at all. No. This is our divide. When we started the podcast, I wanted a podcast. I have a lot of things to say.
Yeah,
I like to ramble. Mm-hmm.
And no one would let you on. No one else would let you on their podcast enough for you.
Right. well, there's a lot of people. You know, I kind of wanted to do my own thing. When people invite you in, they typically invite you to help them do something. They want you for your user base, your followers. They want you because you have one subject that you know a lot about that you wanted to cover. And I didn't want that. I wanted it to be me rambling about ham radio.
He wanted his own kingdom.
I want my own kingdom. I want my own territory. I want my own rules. And Sterling sort of wanted that. You know, we talk about...
Yeah.
You know, we talk about phased arrays to contesting to weak signal VHF to youth to old farts to remotes and everything in between.
And, you know, we throw our opinions around and you know, we don't worry about like, you know, we're going to hurt anybody's feelings. We bring in the technical side for Marty and I bring in like I like to talk about like the philosophical side or the future of ham radio and that sort of stuff, too. So
the technical side from Marty, because you're the electrical engineer.
It's
Marty,
weird, right?
Marty's a junior high school student.
Uh-huh. But yeah. He likes to talk. I mean, I am an electrical engineer and I do radio stuff, but for a living now, but he's, I guess, the passion. And I really like I really like seeing cultivated in Marty's like ramblings, like his goings on about beverage antennas and phase arrays. Cause I learned stuff too that I didn't know. And
not everything that we talk about actually makes the show.
Yeah,
I have been known to go on some rants that were deemed not appropriate by Sterling.
So the wrong guy is editing.
He's the sort of adult. Yeah. And neither of us are very good at editing.
All right.
But Sterling is the, you know, the smart, educated, good-looking guy who knows things. And I just ramble.
Let's just check this out here. Okay, there you go.
What's up?
Okay, I'm just looking for smart, educated, and good-looking.
Yeah,
we needed to have you full screen for that.
Well, I did do I get a haircut just before this, so I'm looking my best right now.
Okay. So you wanted to do your, that's pretty much how this show got started. I was on Ham Nation and they stopped calling and I wanted to do something. And so here I am. David, when do you start your own show?
Yeah.
I'm not sure about that.
Yeah. Get sick of you.
You know, I get to get up in front of 60 or 70 people a couple times a week and talk to them. When they all kick me out, then I'll have to find a venue, and that might be my own podcast. We'll see.
Okay.
So for
the Ham Radio Now audience, I just wanted to congratulate David on his new camera and his new microphone.
Woohoo!
What is that, an ATR 2100?
Yes, I believe it is.
Yeah.
See, he knows his stuff.
Yeah. It worked out good. It worked out really well and easy. And I had actually had the microphone stand in the garage. We had a garage sale about 4 months ago, and I told my wife, no, I'm going to use it for something someday. And look, I'm using it.
Yeah. It's like about an $80 microphone, and it sounds...
it depends. It literally depends on the day.
Yeah. And it sounds like 90% as good as these PR40s.
Right.
Yeah. And I have
the microphone I'm using, the microphone Gary's using, they're what, $350 a pop?
So, yeah, sort of. Everything. Again, it depends on the day. Okay, I can't hear you guys because my
And thank you, Gary, for having me get this one instead of the $350 one.
Talking about
And then the camera upgrade, again, the camera upgrade was, that was Hanukkah. That worked out good. I just have to figure out it's wider than the other one. So yeah. I'm having to work the shack in, and I had to do a little more cleanup than I was hoping to do, but it's okay.
Well, this is also the first time that you've appeared from your shack.
Yeah.
Because you've been in your office.
We were at work last time we talked. Last time I did a show with you.
No, when we did that first show, I was in the home office. We've agreed that I won't do shows from the home office because there's real work going on inside the home office. And I'm not doing it. So somebody
is this
else.
Is this not real work? I think we are creating exciting content. We both ask for donations for our work.
Yes.
You guys much more successfully.
Oh yeah, I forgot to mention Ham Radio Now is brought to you by
you. Brought to you by you.
Arvin is the chief financial officer. He invites you to stop by hamradionow.tv where you can contribute by PayPal, Patreon being the monthly contribution, or just a plain old credit card. And now the fundraising
let me pitch it here. Sterling
there, Marty.
Pitching. Yeah. And just like Ham Radio Now, the Phasing Line is also brought to you by you. And PhasingLinePodcast.com is our website. Find all that interesting information there. As we record this, you'll see that our last episode was almost 3 weeks ago. Mm-hmm. We really do apologize. But this is here. And if you like this, you like Gary more, you should support him too. But please, PhasingLinePodcast.com is the website. And you can click on that big old Patreon link. Or just go to patreon.com/phasinglinepodcast and give us a little love, whatever you can.
Where's the big old Patreon link? Which one of these is Patreon?
Scroll down. If you go down below, in every episode, we link it. Libsyn does not let you put in buttons.
Yeah, I haven't made an actual website for this. This is just the Libsyn, default website. So it's in there a little bit right above nt1k.com up on the very top. Yeah.
Patreon.com,
phasinglinepodcast. One more.
Scroll up.
Right there. Nope, down.
There you go.
There it is. So, we use Patreon, and it's pretty good so far, but I know you just mentioned you use PayPal, and I've been kind of interested. I know a lot of people would just do a one-time donation because Patreon's, recurring monthly. So you can pay $1 a month, literally, and that'd be super cool.
You got four people at $23 a month so far.
Yeah. So it's been working so good. And our goal is only $30 a month, and that pays for...
Our goal is going to have to go up because we are losing... We'd be losing money at $30 a month.
Yeah.
But we're still losing
money. Right now, that pays for hosting, but it doesn't pay for the monthly... I use Audition, so I have a student version of Audition, which is $20 a month to edit. And, it'll go up a little bit, but really that shouldn't mean anything for, we're not going to make videos or podcasts because we don't have enough. We're still always going to do this because I have a job. So,
difference, Gary, is he's saying we're passionate about what we do.
I'm showing my Patreon, 51 patrons, $321 a month right now. So, but that's been going for about a year.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So, and plus all of my listeners are old and they make money.
Right. We attract, and I think that's kind of one of the cool things here, or one of the cool things with what we're doing here. Our audiences are kind of different, but you offer a lot of content that is geared to them, like the Tapper forums you record. Lots of technical information there for the young people. But it's generally different.
No young people watch that.
I think young people, I think
I get the demographic off of Facebook. I can tell you no young people watch any of this.
I really like some of the digital communication stuff, cause that's like, you know, future stuff. And I'm 25, but I watch it like, I'll skim ahead like 2 minutes. I'll skim ahead another 2 minutes. So I don't know if it's catching me.
So you're the ones that are the little blip.
Like in the middle of it. Yeah.
The audience retention graph.
I watched the episode that Gary's episodes take a lot more to watch because you have to sit in front of them.
Yeah.
And they're not, I don't think you really pay attention to the audio people when you're creating the show.
Not deliberately.
Not deliberately. Nor do we, and we're only audio. But when I just watched that great interview you did with John Amadeo, which I think this is something we could kind of whine about here for a little bit without boring David out.
jump in anytime, show length. David.
I will.
Show length, because, you know, we do a semi-long show. You do a long show.
Mm-hmm. Mostly, yeah.
Maybe people don't. I don't think people want long shows, but I can't stop talking.
Right, it's very hard to get them to shut up.
All the shows on Twit are at least an hour long, and many of them an hour and a half, and some 2 hours. Somebody wants long shows,
and they listen to those shows for sure. Like, I mean, I know I do, mostly because, you know, I commute in a car back and forth. So some of their hour and a half or 2 hour shows, it's not a problem at all.
I mean, Twit, which is This Week in Tech, it's a very big technology podcast, is what, a 3 hour show?
Yeah. Often, yeah. Yeah.
And the tech guy's a 3 hour show?
Yep. And
we watch these on our commutes, and I end up like I guess Ham Radio 360 could be, or the Workbench podcast sometimes, it's like a 2 hour show.
Yep.
But I listen to it over a few days, and it's no problem.
Every show on TV is an hour show at least. Except for the half-hour sitcoms, and you binge watch them. And I'm going to call all of you out there in the audience. I know what you do. You binge watch Netflix for 5 hours.
Right.
So don't talk to me about the show being too long.
You, Gary, binge watch Netflix.
Guilty.
Don't talk to me about things taking too long.
Well, I think some of the differences, you know, like you talked about Workbench and some of the other Twit stuff. It's mostly audio, right? You don't really have to watch it. Ham Nation's a different animal, but that's a shorter show. But, you know, like Security Now and some of the enterprise stuff that I listen to on those, and I can get in my car and have my hour and a half commute to work and listen to those. Whereas, you know, the Tapper stuff and some of the other stuff that, you know, Gary does or we do, it's somewhat more visual.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Now this show will be on yours. It's just an audio show.
Yeah,
and I'll put it out as audio, and I'll put it out as video, but it's fine as just audio.
Because all you're looking at is our faces.
Yeah. You know what? The audience doesn't know, the real motivation for this is so somebody else can edit it.
I won't edit. I just
you'll just throw it together, and then I'll steal the audio.
Out it goes.
Yeah.
So I want to call you guys out on something. You say you're young hams. I claim you are old hams in young bodies.
Young bodies.
Yeah. Because your interest in ham radio is primarily the plain old ordinary stuff. And now, to prove that I actually listened to your show, Sterling, you caught my attention a couple of episodes back when you said that to get young people into ham radio, you need all the new digital stuff. And you said that's not true. That's a myth.
Mm-hmm. Actually, I said that's not true.
Okay, well, let's go to the audio tape.
I agree with it.
And now to the
You got proof. You got proof. Roll it, Gary.
I don't have it. No, I don't have it.
Oh, you don't.
Dialed up. I should, because I didn't know I was going to get pushback. But it's the conventional wisdom that it takes some apparently unspecified digital form of ham radio, because no one's ever said exactly what that is. Hey, they just said,
oh, it's digital.
The kids like that digital stuff, you know, their iPads and their digital.
And then, at the same time, while they're talking about the digital, there's people, you know, and you guys probably have different opinions on this, but I'm going to slam them right out and say that people talk about, oh, kids like contesting because it's like video games.
Mm-hmm.
It's just so false.
Well, so I guess I don't know. But anyway, I think it was Sterling, but one of you said, you know, why would you think kids would want to get on PSK31 and have a slow text conversation? So then the question becomes, well, if not that, what? And so that leads me to, dial up my tablet again here, to actually bring up the first thing on the list of things to talk about now that we're in for the 40 minutes. Yeah. Sterling, you did point out a somebody else's podcast and recommend that we all listen to it. You mentioned this over on Reddit. Mm-hmm. And it was one of Eric Guth, 4Z1UG. Yeah, yep. Eric is Israeli ham, and he does a podcast.
American guy living.
He lives. He lives in Israel. Mm-hmm. And he's got the podcast called QSO Today. I've got it here on my web thing here. And he's already added another episode since the one we're going to talk about here, but this is the one that we were thinking about. Yep. It's Brooke Allen. Yeah, N2BA. It was a very interesting, unusual episode. Because of the things that Brooke talked about. And
click on the link at the top, I think. I want to go to Burning Man now after listening to that.
Yeah.
127. I know. I want to bring ham radio communication networks QSO to Burning Man. Like, it really inspired me.
Options for being a QSO Today cool. supporter or on the right
and
side.
And I'm going to be honest,
notes.
I do not have a chance to listen to this interview.
Are you guys hearing this?
For more information, please visit the QSO Today website at www.qsotoday.com. And click on the support menu at the top of the page.
He's doing his fundraising. So let me just go move in randomly here.
It's a wonderful house and nice property.
I'm going to move in randomly more.
Cool. So I said, yeah, how about YN2SEX? And he says, that's great. Let's do that. And it turns out YN2SEX was already taken.
So this is where Eric started to get really uncomfortable.
I said, okay. Yeah. Well, he was like, this needs to be a family show.
I'm going to make a special event station commemorating the 1,200,000,000th anniversary of the invention of sex, right? Turns out the universe is like 14 billion years old.
Yeah. Anyway, this is...
Do we have to bleep that out on the air?
No, not me. We're recommending that you all go listen to this if you haven't already. Go over to Eric's website, qsotoday.com, and look for episode 127. It's, speaking of long episodes, it's almost as long as my interview with John Amadeo. It's like over 2 hours, about 2 hours.
But that's very unusual for his shows. Usually his shows are about an hour.
Yeah.
Well, it's however long it takes him to read the script.
Yeah. And it was super fascinating. Like, I mean, they had a lot to talk about and they have even more to talk about. I know Brooke Allen, he writes on, he has a website, brookeallen.com. He used to be a stock trader at Wall Street. And then became like this really, I guess, self-renowned writer for ham radio who brings a lot of new ideas, basically.
Yeah, new perspective.
Ham radio. Yeah, new perspective, new everything. And this is
a strange perspective.
He's created some weird things people would think. Hamwidows.com, or this one here on screen, is basically what happens when all of the men who are playing ham radio are left alone forever. So he's created this kind of phony thing, Hamwidows.com. And it's taking something like ridiculous, right? But it's actually bringing like a lot of perspective into the like humor side of ham radio. He started
is he involved with ham hijinks?
No, I don't think so.
But he should be.
It's another one of those satirical websites.
Yeah, dude, I love how he's got a picture of a Yagi in every single one of these photos.
Not this one.
Not that one.
Take a closer look there. Whatever you want that to mean.
But. And then he's also made a Nicaraguan special event on the celebration on the invention of sex. And of course he had tons of hate mail and a ton of like people who are like, oh, you're making ham radio terrible. This is, you're doing it wrong. And it really wasn't. Like, it was really funny. It was really humorous and it was really successful, but it also brought out all the curmudgeons that give us an idea of people who like are not necessarily, I don't know when I want to say like perpetuating, they're not perpetuating, but they're not like making ham radio good. Like, they're bringing it down because they're bringing it to a level of what they
sitting in their basements.
Yeah, what they want ham radio to be, and they're kind of like evangelizing like their idea of ham radio, but to you know.
And yeah, the challenge with those guys is, you know, unless you've been a ham for 20 years and you can do 30 words a minute CW, you know, you shouldn't even have a ticket.
Right. Yeah. Well, I want to talk about two things. And the first one is a connection to that. And the second one is a completely different subject. The first one of that is I think we're going to see a lot of things. What is it? Whiskey 3T, W3 Tango is an upcoming special event for Trump's inauguration.
Oh, boy.
They're going to get so much hate mail. So much hate mail.
They should do that. Yeah. I mean, whether it's Trump or anybody else, that's one of those, it's the office.
It's the office, respect the office. But yeah.
Although that's getting to be a harder and harder thing. And not just Trump. It's, you know, every...
Right, we're not getting political.
Yeah, every successive year, things get more and more polarized. And so it gets harder to respect the office because you can't respect, you think.
The person sitting in the office.
Yeah, mm-hmm. From whichever side. Obama got absolutely no respect from a large segment of the population. Trump gets no respect.
Nor do I think Trump will either.
Yeah.
But I kind of wanted to say, so a lot of people talk, this is kind of the answering the question before people ask the question, which is, you know, every time I talk on somebody else's show or somebody talks in my show, they have one question. How do we get more youth into ham radio? And if I got a dime for every time I answered that question, I would not be podcasting.
Do you have an answer?
But I'd be running DX in the Caribbean. So I don't really have an answer because every answer I've heard seems stupid, just incorrect. Or I don't think there's a magic solution. I do have some ideas.
Well, Brooks said something that you have said in a different way, Sterling, which is you don't get young people into ham radio. You get ham radio into young people.
Into young people.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I try to push the idea of not only that, like, for example, you want to get ham radio into colleges because especially in engineering colleges like S&T, for example, because ham radio represents like a really good way of learning, using the things that you learn in class on the air. And then, you know, it creates like a really good feedback loop. You get more interested in the ham radio. You get more interested in the electrical engineering. That helps your career. That helps you as a person. So it's not like trying to drag the horse to water. It's like, here's some water. It's really good water.
You can drink it, but you don't have to drink it.
Right.
And I guess I have two theories. You could pretty much call them conspiracy theories like everybody else has. The first of which is I think kids are afraid of taking tests. We take them all day in school. We sure as heck don't want to take them in our free time.
Are they afraid or they just don't want to do
finish.
It? Yeah, okay.
Let me finish. Because my idea won't make sense unless I
finish. I'll promote you to full screen here.
Okay. But I think adults aren't afraid of tests. I think adults are afraid of the code. I don't think kids are afraid of Morse code at all. But I think adults are. It's interesting as there's been talk in recent years or recent months really about like the reinstating of possibly of a test similar to the original novice license, which was very, very minimal theory, you know, 3 pages of study material. But you had to know the code. And I'd be intrigued to see what happens with that because I really don't think kids are scared of Morse code. I think kids are scared of taking the damn tests.
Mm-hmm.
Or don't want to study. I don't want to study for tests.
Yeah, I mean, when we did it, and like Gary said earlier, we're old hams and young bodies. Like I was really impassioned to take this test because it looked like something super fun, and it's exactly what I was like, you know, inspired to do. But like any old kid off the street is gonna like, wait, should I take a test for this? Like, you know, and there could be something really cool in ham radio that they want to do, but they're limited by the test. And I mean, it's hard to say we can't just get rid of the test because then you bring in a whole ton of more problems. Because the whole idea of the test is kind of a filter to keep everybody like a technically inclined or technically inspired to do this hobby thing.
Oh, we all know people who have no technical ability and become hams
that's
easily.
Also true.
And I don't think there's anything wrong with that. I got a lot of friends who are zero technical and they've got ham licenses and they enjoy the hobby.
Yeah, and I have a lot of very good technical friends who are not remotely technical.
Yeah.
And have ham radio.
And I think that's, I guess, one of the original ideas of the licensing. So maybe my like argument's a little bit bunk on that.
Are the ham radio tests don't test if you know the material. They test if you're willing to learn the material.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And spending 10 hours is a good way to weed somebody out.
Yeah, even Riley Hollingsworth said that passing your test is not the beginning of ham radio, or is not the end of your learning in ham radio.
It's not the very beginning.
I mean, I passed my general and even my advanced, and I was the biggest idiot ham that you've ever seen.
And let me point out something else. When you get that technician test, which is 35 questions, any EE, who takes 4 years of college probably can pass it without studying.
I mean, you could do the extra even.
Yeah, you might need to memorize some frequencies and stuff that's not intuitive at all. But yeah, I think the technician is currently easy enough to be the novice.
And when you pass that technician test, you can, first of all, get on the lower VHF bands all you want, but you can run 1,500 watts on 10, 24, 47 gigahertz. Think about that.
I mean, if you can find a 1,500 watt transmitter at any of those frequencies,
and get it set up and really transmit on it.
But you can kill yourself with 10 watts at 10 gigahertz.
Yeah,
but get 1,500.
There are a few people out there that have all of the chops it takes to do 20 gigahertz or 47 gigahertz.
47
and. Getting a ham license lets them play with that more than anything commercial would let them do. So, let's.
Right, but at the same time, my point here is we give people lots of people want to use the allocations they don't have, which makes them upgrade. But we have all the spectrum, and it's not a matter of if, it's a matter of when we lose the upper UHF. Because most of our frequencies,
They've been slowly eroded. I mean, we had everything at one point. We had everything above 300 megahertz. So clearly they've been eroded. Marty is bringing up the ghost of incentive licensing.
Yeah.
Well, it was before my lifetime we had everything above 300. We had it because no one could use it.
And then people,
beyond technology. Yeah,
and then 800 and 900 got taken in 2305.
And that happens. I feel like, to try to bash your point or try to keep that from happening. Like, I'm really interested in high gigahertz stuff. And that brings in ideas like HamWAN and like data networks, emergency data networks. Like, that stuff seems really cool to me, but I never have really done anything with it because I don't know.
This is the young hams and old bodies thing.
Yeah. Is
that the thing that is going to bring ham radio to younger people?
No, not at all. No, because to transmit a signal at 2.5 gigahertz, you really need to know what you're doing just to get a signal to radiate, not to do it safely, just to do it.
Well, if you're building the thing, but unless you want to,
a new ham isn't going to, go out and buy a 10 gig station and be on the end of the day, at the end of the day. And it's a bad idea for us to encourage that because they're not going to have instant gratification there.
But what if we had a geostationary satellite on 10 gigahertz? That would be some gratification.
Yeah, we're not going to have a geosynchronous satellite.
Geo something way up there that just sits right there.
I had to look up the difference between geostationary and geosynchronous, and there is a difference.
Yeah.
I mean, geostationary is geosynchronous, but not vice versa.
It's
not recursive.
But they're not mutually exclusive.
It doesn't even have to be a geosynchronous. Yeah. It could be any other, lower term where you actually have to track it, as it goes along, but still that's a lot of fun.
I think the satellites though is definitely a new ham. A lot of new hams take to that. Yeah.
But when that satellite that Bob McGuire was talking about at the Tapper conference is up and running, we will see off the shelf equipment for it and it won't be expensive.
Right.
Pardon my ignorance. What's the background on this?
Bob McGuire, in for HY, super genius ham, head of some advanced technology stuff at Virginia Tech and does a lot of work with NASA. And they're
ham sci. He's a
oh yeah, 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 yeah.
Yeah. They're building, they're in the process of building a, geosynchronous satellite, transponder. They're not building the satellite. It's going to ride on somebody else. There's no way a ham is going to launch a geosynchronous satellite.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's like a $1 billion task.
Yeah. So there, a satellite is going up.
Billion, not million.
Yeah. Satellite is going up probably next year for geosynchronous orbit. And the reason not geostationary, it's not a communication satellite. It's primarily weather satellite. Mm-hmm. So it's got to move up and down and see different oceans and stuff. But it will always be in view of the Americas above our heads. 24 hours a day. And as he described it, and it looks like this is getting pretty well locked in because they're getting a lot of the hardware done. 1,000 channels, 10 kilohertz wide, all digital. And channels can be bonded. Well, 5 gigahertz up, I think, and 10 gigahertz down. Ah.
That's a lot of channels. Yeah. See, I was kind of worried, like, what's going to happen when, you know, the public, I guess, general public gets a wind of this. And they start pirating, like using it as their own FRS, like CB radio.
Well,
you know, I wonder.
The only way to get hams to do things they don't want to is make them do it.
Yeah.
Well, yeah.
In his talk, he briefly addressed the concept of authentication. There've been a lot of talks at Tapper about authentication for things.
And
like
I imagine,
that.
Like something like because with D-Star, you have to basically log in and register yourself before you can get on the network and get on the gateway. So I can see something like that.
And it's even more prevalent with DMR, where you have to get a number and people can block you. And that's been a big political mishmash in ham radio. People are getting kicked out, basically.
Mm-hmm. Squirrel.
Yeah.
Sorry, Marty. You just saw a squirrel. So,
what?
Marty's too young. When you see a squirrel, it's like suddenly the conversation goes off the rails and heads off to a different track. So we were talking about a satellite for a moment.
What did I start talking about?
No, we started with getting youth involved in amateur radio,
and then we talked about satellites.
But I'm thinking if this geosynchronous satellite is up there and the hardware is a couple of $100 to get
on
it.
Can I finish my dang thought?
Would old hams who want to work DX on 20 meters are never going to get on that satellite.
Right.
But a 22-year-old, you offer a 22-year-old the opportunity to operate through a satellite that's on the air 24 hours a day. And all he's got to do is get this hardware and a ham license. And what is he going to do through it? Is he going to rag chew through it? Well, he could, but all kinds of other things that I can't even think of right now. But you guys probably can start thinking of things to do with a digital, something that's going to handle a bunch of different digital modes.
But mm-hmm. I don't know. I think it's important that they do a lot of modes because as soon as you try one, you're going to get sick of it.
Sterling. I mean, I don't know about that because I kind of agree with Gary in some part of the idea. It is really, really cool, but a lot of people are going to ask, like, well, I can just do Skype. Like, what we're doing right now, I can't do this over the satellite. But you got to listen to that episode with Brooke Allen on QSO Today, because he brought it, he really succinctly, basically, he inspired me. He persuaded me why ham radio is cool. In his words, it's freaking magic, but a different word was used. But basically, the idea
you must
that...
must have made 4Z1UG very uncomfortable.
Well, at the end, like, it ended up being way, like, better than he thought. So he kept all of that, you know, I guess racy talk. Some people would consider it very, like, sketchy, but he kept it because it was, like, actually really important.
Yeah.
To hear and understand.
Racy talk in 1946. Not today. This is, as I like to keep reminding people out there in the audience, this is 2016. No, this is 2017.
2017.
Yep.
This is 2017.
Gary doesn't know what year is it?
This was recorded in 2016.
No, it wasn't. 2017.
Yes, it was. That's how long it takes Gary to edit things.
January 14th, 2017.
Oh, man, I'm so old.
We're on Facebook Live. People are watching.
Yeah, a few people. That's cool.
Yeah, there's
on Facebook
13
Live,
of them out there.
13.
That's going to double. That's half the audience that the whole recorded thing is going to get.
Say, okay, the NT1K says, say babu, baby you.
Say what?
Baby you?
I have no idea what you're talking about.
Yeah, I missed it.
He says, say baby you on the comments on the video, on the live stream. Somebody just disappeared when I said
Why would we want to do that?
Yeah. Because it's what our viewers want. And
oh, I don't care.
Gary's never really been into the whole what the viewers want. It's the show.
Yeah, it's what Gary.
But I want to, you know, really, you know, want to go circle back to the whole, you know, ham radio and youth, because I think that is an important thing. I know Gary's been working towards that. I know it sounds like Marty, maybe you're not so interested in that.
No.
He doesn't want to be the voice of youth. But
no, I get it. And you know,
I want to be respected not because I'm a kid, but because I'm smart.
I'm a smart guy.
But maybe I'm not smart yet. Could tell me what the vision, who's your audience, who is it?
Of the phasing line or of me?
We'll start with the phasing line because that's what's, you know, out there right now.
When Sterling and I talk, we preach, or we don't preach. I'll say preach. We
I can't preach.
Convey information to people. Typically our target audience is medium age to older people who have some technical experience, but not a ton. You know, the 4 to 6 year vets of radio who are just getting into HF or getting involved in HF.
Mm-hmm.
Who kind of want to hear something a little bit off the wall. Along.
Yeah.
What's medium age to you? 20?
Median
15?
Age of ham radio?
For you and your audience.
37, 52. 64.
Okay. So the age, I think you guys are in your heads.
Age is very important.
Okay.
It's the somewhat technical content.
So it's basically what he's saying is like, it's more like some veteran hams who've got their general class or tech class and have been in ham radio for a while, is what I think he's trying to say. And I also like when, so that's kind of Marty's side of things. And if I'm answering a question, I'm basically talking to myself. But also I'm trying to, cause every time Marty comes up with something technical, I always ask, and I know the answer to the question, I always ask like, wait, what is a bazooka? Why do they call it that? Or what is, why do they call it a beverage antenna? Or what is it?
I talk like I think.
Yeah.
I think very clearly.
And so I catch him on it and I guess I, to lack of a better term, dumb it down so that everybody can understand it and also be really interested in it. Like, oh, that's cool. But I really like to push to the youth demographic, but not say like, this is a podcast for young people, young kids all over the place.
That's a kiss of death.
Yeah. And like Marty's going to say like every time you've, you know, oh, you're young, you're such
young,
a kiddo.
We know, based on analytics that old people like hearing about young people talk about ideas about young people.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm kind of sick of it.
But that's what they want to hear. And so that's also one of our demographics. Right. It's like answering the question, how do you get youth into ham radio?
So your show isn't specifically doing that because your audience isn't young. Your audience is older than you guys are.
Right, but we don't want to tell people, you know, you don't need to tell young people how to get youth in ham radio if they're already in ham radio.
Mm-hmm. We're kind of showing it. We're not saying like, you're going to get youth into ham radio like this. We're saying, here's two young people.
When you're in, you know, journalist or in J school or, you know, when you're in elementary school, if you're a kid and you start learning with journalism, they always, you know, they always say, show, don't tell. Mm-hmm. So we're kind of showing our lives. Think of it as an open diary of my day-to-day life in ham radio.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's a phrase that's used in another aspect of my life. It's called attraction, not promotion.
Mm-hmm.
So
yes,
yeah, I can do that.
Yeah.
So, Brooke was suggesting some changes for contests to attract young people into things.
Oh, I have some very strong opinions.
You know, gamification of contesting.
Yeah.
Gamification.
You know, and
this is where my old fart side takes over.
Yeah, I mean, it sounds like first of all, you were saying that contesting is not what you think is the way to. Interest, you know, one of those conventional wisdom things again, young people will be interested in
contesting because it's like video games.
Okay. So, what?
I am an active contester, and I think some of what influences my opinions when it comes to, radio and contesting is kind of the fact that I haven't done too badly in it. I've finished top 10 in some big contests, and I'm not bad at it. So I don't really care for handicaps or whatever. A lot of adults talk about, you know, when you have a new kid or somebody new in ham radio, let's make it easier for them to win in a contest. Radio sport contest, that is, on the HF bands typically. Let's make it easy so they stick around for a little bit. But to me, that bores me because as soon as you're done with that handicap, once you pass that allotted amount of time, you're now kind of dumped off into the rest of the world. I don't think it teaches you a lot. I much rather struggle a little bit, start, try and work up to a high level. And because I've been somewhat successful at that, I guess that kind of clouds my viewing. But I think ham radio contesting is a fun thing, and I think you can attract youth as is. But I don't think we should, I don't think we should be changing our hobby to accommodate people who aren't in our hobby, for lack of the proper way to say it.
And I think Brooke's point in the podcast was, kind of along the lines of what Sterling's doing for your podcast. He's trying to make it more accessible, right? So, and I get Marty, you don't want, and I, you know, I'm back and forth about inviting other people in that really aren't interested and don't want to play along and don't want to do what we want to do. But on the other hand, like opening up, so it is more accessible to people who
don't quite get it. How does
she want to
make it more accessible though?
Well, the whole gamification. So one of the things he said in the podcast, and you didn't listen to it. So,
shame on me.
We're at a disadvantage because you can't talk from the same frame of reference. But so one of the things he talked about was, along with the signal report, maybe you'd want to throw in how you're feeling right now, right? And so that would bring in more YLs in his mind, right? And I'm not sure it will or it won't.
That sounds like outright sexism to me.
Well, he's trying to add something to it that he thinks, I'm not sure it's right or wrong or it'll work or it won't work, yeah. But to get other people involved, to get them interested in wanting to get in there and share, other than, you know, you're 5'9" into Los Angeles. Okay, well, that's great. But for you and for me, and I'm interested in getting you in the log, that's great. But sharing ideas and talking and connecting people is kind of where he was going with all this. Right. And for a lot of people, they're not just interested in getting you in the log. They want to make that contact, make that connection.
Right. Mm-hmm. And I think it's more, or to me, the way I look at that is, let's separate those things. I like contesting because of that fast-paced, how fast can I get you in the log, 5'9", thanks, QRZ. Mm-hmm. And some people don't like that, and I think we should kind of respect both parts. You know, there's more casual contests and there's more serious contests. Right now, as we record this, there's the NAQP CW contest, 12-hour contest, Saturday day in North America. And it sort of gets at that. What's your name? What's your state? Thanks.
Yeah, and that's what I was thinking of, like, because that kids puts it on a more personal level, like with the exchange and the NAQP is your name. And sometimes people make up funny names like Rumpelstiltskin, because then you have to write down in the log Rumpelstiltskin. But then you also see guys who are in the like faster contesting who just call themselves Ed, Joe, Jim.
I use Jim a lot.
Yeah, and I use Joe because they want to be faster paced and get through it really quick. So you have to like, you know, consider like both sides of the things, both sides of the like, or, I mean, all sides, all facets of people's interests. And because like Marty's really into fast pace. Yeah. And I like connecting to people more. And like if I hear somebody who I know on a contest, I'll look up on HamQRZN, maybe send them a little message. But he definitely brings attention to the whole idea that we need to start looking at different, maybe small minor changes, maybe not even changes, maybe a gentleman's agreement or something like that to modify, and not just like every contest.
Why should we be modifying if we can add?
Well, I think that's his point. Wasn't it to take away the ones we got, is to add to them. I kind of wonder how you avoid the 5'9"ification of anything you do, right? Like your feelings.
It'd be
name.
Like, I 5'9", I feel fine. Thank you. Bye. Like, you know, I'm sure that'll happen, but that's just like, I guess one thought.
It could. Brooke's concern was, you know, as I think all of us are concerned, is over time we could lose a spectrum if we don't bring more people in. And so mm-hmm. I think what he was looking really to do was like, how do you reach more people other than the 700,000 of us that, you know, got our at least a tech ticket in the United States? He's trying to figure out a way to say, hey, maybe we could get a couple thousand or 100,000 or whatever number of people into the program if there was some more connection to it.
Yeah. And one of his bigger points was trying to do speed dating through ham radio. And it wasn't just a 5'9", I feel good. It was like basically getting a bunch of like YLs and women and men and women on the air to meet each other, you know, and try to have a dating aspect. So that would be really cool to have a dating contest where you can try to make his contact with, you know, members of the
Here's how to get more women.
We have an important interruption here.
Here's how to get more women into ham radio. Cats.
Yeah.
Which cat do we have here?
This is the peanut.
That the new one?
Yeah. And this is the first time she's come up and actually Dun, dun. Yeah. Said, Daddy, pay attention to the peanut. There I am.
Peanut.
Oh. Parrot cat.
Your cat's really like sitting up on your shoulder there.
There's a lot of mouse in that one. Yeah, they do.
Mine like walking up on the walls. I don't know where mine are right now. But I got Abby and Charlie who like to make guest appearances occasionally.
Yeah. So one of the questions that Brooke asked and that Eric did not have a ready answer to, and I think most hams won't have one, is why must ham radio go on? Why do we need to keep it going? Why not just turn it off when the last guy leaves, turn off the lights, turn off the spectrum, and give it over to...
Whoever wants it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think there's... Dave, I'd really like to hear David's answer on this one, because I know he comes from a background of MCOM and preparedness.
Yeah. If I put my MCOM hat on and we turn this into a MCOM extra show, we need to have amateur radio for, when the stuff hits the fan, that we can have communications, Los Angeles, the Southern California, we have earthquakes. I know where Gary is, you guys have,
hurricanes, tornadoes.
Yeah, exactly. So in the event when something happens, I'm big on community service and want to be able to provide that community service to help out when it's needed. And there is a large number of the hams out there. I know, especially the ones that go through the training programs that we do, every quarter here. In fact, there'll be a class tomorrow where hopefully by the end of the day, there'll be another 30, 35, technician class, hams. Primarily people are doing it to do community service in MCOM and, either work with CERT or whatever group it is, ARIES, and so on and so forth. We need it for that. I think there's probably value in the kind of contesting that you do, Marty, as well. The DXing, reaching across borders and cutting the lines of, yeah, you may be in another country, but you have similar interests and can reach out and talk to each other and hopefully you're doing more than telling them they're 5'9" into wherever you happen to be and then moving on to the next guy. You make that connection and the communication.
Does that happen?
When I'm running a 300 hour, I do not care about you. I want you to be concise. I want you to be quick, and I want you to give me your exchange so you can get the heck out of my way and I can work some other guys.
Sterling, he's in flow and he doesn't know it. He's in flow and he doesn't. Yeah.
Exactly. He doesn't want to get his flow.
That's one of the things that Brooke said that I had not. I'm aware of the concept of flow or being in the zone, but he said when your abilities precisely match the task at hand, and you go into that state of flow. And I thought I never considered it that way. Although there's no guarantee that you will. Professional athletes, of course, everything is clicking, they're in the zone, but there's no guarantee
and sometimes they just have an off day.
I think there's always tricks to the trade. Like, especially in contesting, I do most contests, I do SO2R, which is single op two radios, a radio in one ear and a radio in the other. And there's a lot of technique there, and I sure as heck I haven't figured it out, but that always keeps me in the chair. What antennas can I use? What band should I be on at 10? Well, I'm getting a big pileup of Europeans. Let me not use the full stack of Yagis.
Yeah.
Let me just use the bottom one, so I'll be weaker and I'll have a smaller pileup, so I'll be able to pull out calls back faster, so I'll be able to work more guys.
Yeah, and when you're in flow, you don't even know.
So Marty, when there's not a contest weekend on, are you still getting on the radio and are you still working the DX?
Sure. When you
do that, do you make the connection or you still just want to get him in the log and work towards your DXCC or whatever else you're doing?
I'm not in it for the awards. At this point, I kind of have them all.
He's 14 years old.
That's awesome.
When you make 2,000 or 3,000 or 4,000 contacts a weekend in a DX contest, you get DXCC on multiple bands in the first 12 hours. So it's not that exciting after a while.
Been a ham for 51 years. I don't have DXCC.
You don't have DXCC?
Don't have worked all states.
Doing it in the weekend.
I think I'm like 20 away, but I never keep track. I make contacts and I never even log in.
It's not important to you, right, Gary?
No, not important at all. I've worked 100 countries or more, but I've just, never done the QSL thing.
I don't think I would have done it if it wasn't for LOTW, Logbook of the World, because it's online. I upload my logs and it just happens.
Someday I'll sign up. The other side
to this is a lot of people say, well, you contesters use big, high power stations. That's not fair because I have a small dipole at 50 feet and low power. And I'll tell you, I have a small, I have a dipole. It's probably not at 50 feet, you know, a couple of verticals, some wires in the trees. And I still at home, you know, I don't contest at home a lot. When I do, I can still make 1,000, 1,500, 2,000, probably 1,500 contacts in a weekend.
Yeah. I don't contest very much, but I work a lot of DX from my car, 100 watts and less, far less than a dipole.
Yep. And, you know, I think this is kind of a more political subject, but a lot of people, you know, I operate lots of remote stations, friends stations who have helped remote in exchange for being able to use it. I use the K1TTT Superstation a lot. I also have a membership and a network called remotehamradio.com, which is a very cool place where people can basically buy use of a station on the internet. That's maintained by people typically in North America. But they care about youth and they're excited about youth and ham radio. So they actually allow youth to be able to get on those bigger stations, practice running big pileups, work some DX for free, which is very nice. And it's a terrific
program.
But
not whenever they want.
Radio.com.
Not whenever they want.
What? Yeah, whenever they want.
Well, those stations are time limited and you have to sign up, right?
For a youth, let me share my screen. You know, I could get on right now if I wanted to.
But there's not a contest going, right?
No, but I could still get on and talk to
guys. What if somebody else is on there, though?
Right. I think Gary's point is on a contest weekend, you're probably not, some youth is not just going to jump in there and sign up and try it out.
You can. I don't see what's stopping you.
Well, it's one channel, one station.
No.
10 people can't use it at once.
They have a network of stations.
Well, yeah, what, 20, 30 stations? Yeah. Well, 35 stations is almost nothing compared to the number of hams who might want to use it on a popular
weekend.
Remember,
if you're an adult, you're going to be paying for it.
But some of these guys got money.
You can reserve it. You can reserve a station for a set fee, but I think...
And for how long?
For a contest weekend.
The whole weekend. What's it going to
cost? Weekend, 48 hours.
Can a young person do that for free?
You can work a deal with the owners of Remote Ham Radio, because I think they're really interested in supporting youth in the hobby. You know, right. I'm not going to make any promises on their behalf. But I think they'd probably work something out with you. I don't know.
I know for kids under people under 25. They can get free access, but basically what Gary's mentioning, what if all of them are like used up? What if it's a real big contest weekend? All 35 stations have.
I've never run into that issue. But at the same time, I don't think it's fair to be targeting them to use them as your personal station. You know, somebody.
Well, for many people, like where Sterling is now, can't put up an effective outside antenna.
Right, I mean, if you're paying, that's one thing.
That's the
point. But, you know. I think the remote ham radio guys are worth, but remotes in general. You know?
Probably what we need in the remote ham radio world, and maybe this exists and I just don't know it, is not every station having to be a super station. Just lots of remote stations that are just like your average ham station.
RemoteHamRadio.com does that. They have stations which are a dipole in the woods.
Okay.
100 watts.
That'll be good.
And more of those. More of those would be great. And I also really want to see like more... web SDRs, open web SDRs, like things that you don't even have to transmit, just receive, like a network of those that are way bigger. Because right now it's blowing up, the websdr.org. I think there's a couple hundred stations or 100 or 150 stations. But a lot of them are just on soft rocks and they can only see like a little spectrum of 40 meters, a little spectrum of 20 meters maybe. And now it's getting much cheaper to have the entire spectrum or use a couple of RTL SDRs to see the entire spectrum and throw up a wire. So I've been working, and this is a challenge for listeners in your radio club, to work with hackerspaces and your local amateur radio club to like put up a listening receiving station on web SDR using RTL SDRs, a cheap computer, and a modest antenna in some kind of relatively low noise environment. Right now I'm working with the Arch Reactor, which is our hackerspace in St. Louis, because they have a nice building. It's a little noisy, but you know, they got fast internet and a couple trees in their, like, I guess, backyard and a big space, and they'd really like that. And they're also going to put up like a lightning detector, which would be really cool. But that is an easy way to put on your website, put on your club thing, saying like, here, listen to the spectrum right now. Scan to 14300 to listen to the maritime net. or listen to CW here, listen to that, because that's one of the things that like really seats interest.
And
that,
actually, I know there's a lot of clubs that are now starting to have remote stations for their members, and that interests me.
Yeah, at Boeing we have a Flex 6000 installed in a penthouse in an elevator that you can remote into, and so employees/ members of the club can VPN into the computer up there and activate that. So that's another thought too. It's a lot more expensive. You have to buy a Flex radio and put that on the internet, and it has to be pretty fast, a low latency internet, so you don't miss out too much. But you know, that's another thought. You don't even need a Flex, actually. You can use any HF radio with a computer and audio plugin. Right. You can use Skype and TeamViewer and Ham Radio Deluxe or Rim Audio or FL Digi or FL Rig, all these software programs to
make it run. I've been saying for a while, and I really hope they do it eventually, I'd love to see the ARRL make a remote station for their users.
Mm-hmm.
I think that'd be terrific.
Yeah,
for like W1AW? Issues?
Yeah,
I don't know. The issue you run into, obviously, is if they have whatever the pathetically small amount of members they have is, you know, they want to use their station and they have 5 radios for 30,000 people. You run into issues, but
but you don't think you're not going to see 30,000 people trying to get on radios at once. Right. But if you stream that audio, or if you use something like Broadcastify or WebSphere, you can output that audio like 200, 300, 400 people if you're based on how much you're
but if you're only receiving, but if you want to transmit,
right, and then it's only one person at a time. So
does anybody stream a ham radio contest on Twitch?
I've done it on Facebook.
Yeah, Twitch for a specific reason.
I know NT1K has done it. I've never personally used Twitch.
NT1K. Speaking of Jeff Bale, he's told me to say Baba Booey earlier. So there you go, yeah. Jeff.
Okay, that was
look, Marty, Howard Stern made here on Ham Radio Now.
We should do the annual the comment analysis. Jeff said contesting is about competition and winning, and then he said he contested.
Yeah, but what was the question a minute ago? Do ham radio streaming
on Twitch?
On Twitch,
because Twitch is for all of you old fart hams that don't understand what Twitch is. It's a streaming site primarily for video games. Yeah, and people go nuts. Some of the better gamers, whatever that is, get huge audiences of people just watching them play a video game.
Yep.
And you know, I don't understand.
Something I still don't understand.
But would people be interested in watching? Like, I read the book and saw the documentary on the WRTC, you know, Contact Sport.
Mm-hmm.
And reading the book, you're basically observing people operating the WRTC contest. It's fascinating. Yeah. I might actually watch for a few hours someone streaming one of those guys or one of the other big stations.
The issue is, you bring up a unique case with WRTC. You can't really do that. And the reason you can't do that is it creates a lot of cheating loopholes.
Yeah.
Self-spotting, cheating loopholes. You know, certain people...
You can always put it on a delay.
Issue with WRTC, David.
So I was saying the spotting would be definitely a problem. So do you think if it got recorded that people would watch it after the fact?
Yeah, well, I mean, there's issues with log washing. That's one thing with contesting. If people will listen to, you know, if you bust an exchange in a contest, you can listen on a remote or a recording and get that fixed. So that's definitely an issue.
Well, they can't do that on WRTC because they turn in their logs too quickly.
WRTC stations, but for other stations. The other thing about WRTC is a big part of it is people don't know what the operator behind each call sign is. That's why, for example, for WRTC, you don't get your call sign until 15 minutes before that contest. The reason they give you 15 minutes is so you can program the voice key or the CW sending from the computer. But that's it. You're not allowed. One of the rules is actually you can't, you know, if you sign your call sign on the air, your home call sign, not your WRTC call sign, you have to QSY because you don't want your buddies. We don't want people to have to be chasing around their buddies and working only them and not the rest of the WRTC station.
Oh, yeah, and there might be a better way to do it. Go ahead, Gary.
Perfect opportunity to be a total curmudgeon, because I think what most people don't know in the rules is that if you're operating a special event call sign, you have to give your own call sign every half hour, something like that.
Every half hour?
I've never heard that
it's
one.
It's not every 10 minutes. It's a lot less than the standard, but once in a while, you've got to give
it. It's once every hour. It's definitely a thing. I know you. I've seen that.
We could look it up, but I'm not going to.
Gary doesn't have the page up. Gary doesn't have the page up.
So speaking of page, I sent a thing to the Skype chat, but like I wrote a little bit about this on my blog, n0ssc.com, because I noticed that WT2P, I think his name is CJ, he started streaming on YouTube, which isn't Twitch, but basically more or less live streaming his contests. And I was not like, it harkened back to my days where I watched like Call of Duty and DayZ and like Dota, League of Legends on Twitch. I never played these games. I just literally would sit there and watch and comment and with like huge other groups of people doing the same thing and becoming part of a community that supports the gamer and financially or just like, you know, chatting wise. And you get perks out of it. And I can really see a lot of that in contesting as well. WRTC might not be the easiest because of the rules involved, but you could probably stream the cqcontest.net or I think it's basically
that's actually had some controversy. Yeah, keep going. I don't want to cut you off.
Yeah, no,
I cut everybody off. I'm sorry.
Yeah, everybody knows the story of the PhasingLine podcast.
And I've got a point to make about that in a minute if I remember. So go ahead.
But like cqcontest. I'm going to say .network or whatever. .net. It's a live stream. Live score publishing thing. So basically you can see all of the people who are posting their score on the internet live. And so you can always see like who's winning, who's right behind, and it's live. So it'll update and it might switch over. And that way you can track how well you're doing compared to everybody else. And that's a bit of, it's called social facilitation. So if you're running, if you go out running by yourself, you might run a mile and be like tired and stop running. But if you have a friend, you might run 2, 3, 4 miles because your friend doesn't want to stop running, but you don't want to stop running.
You don't want to start running to see your friend.
So then you like, you know, try to chase each other until you just fall over. And so that's kind of like what I kind of see. Both it benefits the contester, but it also gives a non-contester like a little window into what's going on. And it's really kind of interesting, like, because you might have some, you know, people who you like, who your friends, who you want to follow and cheer on. And then that just kind of blossoms all into live streaming as well.
If a contest has rules that make it difficult to stream it because it's going to, you know, the self-spotting thing or whatever, should we change those rules?
No, but I think we can work around them. You know, one of the common things is, you know, you don't show your frequency on a live stream. I try and avoid that when possible. The other thing about cqcontest.net, when it was originally developed, you had to send what band Acusa was made on. What would happen, you know, if you're a lot of these things are things you only think about as a, you know, a high level contester is, you know, I could be watching K5ZD is his Acusa totals on 10 meters are shooting up. Damn, maybe there's an opening on 10 meters. I better go look at and things like that. So we want to be able to showcase it to the public, but contesters, we want to be careful not to turn these things into tools for other contesters because it's very easy to do that.
But that actually might be a good thing. I mean, so what you're talking about, 10 meter or like a 10 meter opening, if you're assisted, you already know that. You're already getting like a ton of, you know, stuff coming on the telnet that people are making.
But if you're not assisted, then you shouldn't know that.
And well, then you shouldn't live stream or post your score. So you
No. You're allowed to look at an online scoreboard if you're unassisted.
What does assisted mean? Like, if you're allowed to look at an online scoreboard.
Assisted is what we're talking about, what is in the confines of the rules. Assisted as you, I have the actual definition that is assisted. You know, when we talk about assisted, we're really talking about, you know, how you get the information about what queue you're making. As CQ says in the CQ Worldwide contest, kind of the biggest contest of the year, single operator assisted. Entrants in this category may use QSO Finding Assistance, CVII2. And when we look at V3.2, we see that it says QSO Finding Assistance, the use of any technology or other source that provides call sign or multiplier identification to the operator. This includes, but is not limited to, the use of a CW decoder, which we think of as being a way to read what is being sent if you don't know the code. A skimmer, which can decode lots of CW signals at once. A cluster, which skimmers can send to on the internet or telnet. A DX spotting website like DX Summit. Local or remote call sign and frequency decoding technology, like having receivers around the world, etc. You're not allowed to have receivers around the world, etc.
I'm this close to calling boring.
to me, it's very interesting. These people are consistently finding loopholes in this. You'd think it's really cut and dry.
Well, they put et cetera there, but I think if you're running non-assisted, you should just not. You should. I mean, it's the honor code. I'm sure tons of people listen to or watch the telnet. They cheat and they watch the telnet when they say they're unassisted, and people will do that.
It's very hard to track.
But live streaming might fix that too.
It's very hard to track people who are merely looking at the cluster. Mm-hmm. Watching, you know, to see when bands open. It's extremely trivially easy to correlate people who are claiming unassisted but operating assisted, because right. you could follow their radios as they work guys up and down the band map on a given band. Mm-hmm. And at the same time, you could also correlate if they're claiming assisted, if they're claiming unassisted but operating assisted. One of the interesting trends we see is self-spotting. People are self-spotting, which is illegal in contests. And similarly, we see a lot of people in contests when they're claiming unassisted, but really operating assisted. They'll try a lot of tactics like not logging contacts immediately so they fit with band change rules. That's another thing we see in contesting. There's a lot of cheating ways to cheat in contests. In CW contests, a lot of people who are claiming they're single operators while have a different guy operating at night.
Why do hams cheat in contests?
Because radio sport contesting is an ego thing. Who has the biggest station? Who has the biggest score? Who won?
Well, but if you cheat and you won, you get no ego satisfaction because you won by cheating.
You know, but
unless the contest is who could cheat the hardest.
Mm-hmm. Wait, except there's people out there, Gary, that don't
in Europe is. Yeah.
David.
That's slamming. You know, somebody a European once said, "The issue with you North Americans is you guys aren't flexible."
Yeah, and you know, Gary, the point is, it's not that you won by winning; it's that you won and your name's on the list, whether you got there fairly or not.
More importantly, it's okay, everybody will respect me because I won.
So it is. Right. So it is. Who can cheat the hardest?
Yeah, I'm
in
sure.
Europe. In South America.
All right.
I'd like to think Americans are marauders. Obviously, we know of cheaters in America, and you know.
So you're watching the Marty Sullaway everywhere. Contest show. Can I totally change the subject? Would that be okay?
That would be completely okay because I am boring 99% of your listeners.
Okay, and let me posit this: self-driving cars. The end of amateur radio mobile.
David.
Wow. So, okay, I'll jump right in on this. So, California, as of January 1st, I'm not allowed to key my mic anymore. Because they threw in at the last minute some new rules. And the way they redefined everything, if I'm a truck driver or a taxi cab driver or a public utility worker, I'm not allowed to key the mic either. And there's a lot of blowback on that, and so I'm doing less mobile operating just because I don't want the $50 plus whatever the administration fee ticket is. So self-driving cars, I'd actually probably be doing more operating now. Is it mobile or not? Is that the question, Gary? Or
well, the reason I'm thinking self-driving cars are not, and I mean initially I would think yeah, it's great for anything that you want to do that doesn't. That allows you to take your attention away from driving the car. Except I see the problem with self-driving cars as being two things. One is that a consortium of the manufacturers and the insurance companies are going to say, you want to put how much RF in the vicinity of the computer that's driving your car? That's sure. Problem number one.
Oh, yeah.
And problem number two is we ain't going to own a car. You won't have your own self-driving car. You will punch your Uber app and the self-driving car will toot up to your driveway in a couple of minutes. And
Uber's take, already doing
that. And take you where you want to go, but there won't be any radio in that, any ham radio in that.
Well, Tesla's already kind of doing this too. Some of their new cars are you know, quote unquote self driving.
Autopilot. So people
are still owning those. Yeah, autopilot. It's something. It's the start of it, right? Yeah.
Are any of them making a deal about RF?
I haven't seen one. I've read a lot about the.
Sure, it's in like the manual or something.
Once they watch this show, they're yeah. right. just screwed it for all of us.
Obviously, there's, you know, Tesla, who's or whatever companies are going to be making self-driving cars in the next 10 years, have people dedicated to watching ham radio content by men drinking soda from Subway cups.
Yeah.
Yep.
But I don't know. Like, I know a few hams with Teslas, but I know they don't put antennas on it because they don't want to, you know, ruin the value of their car or whatever.
You know, when you're paying $150,000 for a car, you're sure as hell not going to put a hole in it.
So there's going to be this fleet of self-driving cars out there that, again, you want to get to work and you punch a button and it comes and gets you. And the reason why that's all going to exist is it's going to be far more economical for any individual to not own a car and just to have one come get you when you want to go someplace. Specialty cars will appear.
Mm-hmm.
All kinds of specialty cars. You want a party car? You know, that's basically a living room with, you know, rocking car for, you know, to bring, take your folks out to the club. Do you want a business car? Do you want
about a ham radio car?
Well, that's where I was going. Car? Now, are we big enough? Are we big enough? You
know, and how big are all of your families, right? There's 7 people that live in my house.
Yeah.
So, you know, I need that big car. Even if I leave my parents at home, right, then there's, you know, my wife and my 3 kids. So,
yeah.
You're right. There will be a definite, you know, do you pick this? Do you pick that?
Right. And I think right now, I sure as heck know I'm not going to be getting, or my family won't be getting an electric car in the next couple of years because it's not economical. It's still losing money.
Yeah, that's a red herring.
A red herring meaning?
It got nothing to do with the conversation. You're
oh, it does completely.
No.
It does
completely. But
I mean,
in your self-driving car, of course, you could take a handy talkie, but that's not very efficient. Maybe you could plunk a magnet mount up on top. And
that's what I was thinking.
Hey, there's a kitty cat.
Yeah, it's Abby.
But hi, Abby. You know, that's, and I got one down here, but she's out of reach. But that's, you know, just for talking on 2 meters or 440 or whatever, but not HF. You know, I wouldn't be sticking my Tar Heel 213-foot tall motorized whip on the back of the self-driving car. So maybe at the specialty car, I push the ham radio button and, you know, maybe there's 3 or 4 of them driving around the triangle area here.
I mean, if I get one, I'm lucky. One of the things you have to deal with when you're doing a lot of high power contesting is you typically have a lot of antennas that need to be controlled some way smart. So you typically have some sort of electronic control system for, you know, rotators and triplexers and switching, and they all typically have little microprocessors in them. And then you're also transmitting kilowatts of power, which is always an interesting battle. And I can tell you, RF likes to get into these things, and these things like to get in RF.
I'm sure.
In the
car would be more noisy than the ham radio.
And I can tell you, we spend a lot of time... Well, I mean, it's the noise coming into the radios, but more importantly, it's... And you have all this RF around. One loose PL259 I've seen can, you know, wreak havoc on these things. And when you have your PTT lines, your push-to-talk lines going through, a computer before it gets to the radio, and you send too much RF and something locks up, that you got to be very careful. I could only imagine the implications when that sensing device was the pedestrian walking in front of car sensor.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. David, what's going to happen with MCOM when it's self-driving car fleets and we don't own our own cars?
Right? Yeah, well, you know, I'm not sure we're going to get there. I mean, if you think about, so look, I live in Los Angeles, right? And I could see that as an era where we're probably closer to having, you know, less personal ownership, right? Manhattan, less personal ownership. But, you know, if you live out in the country somewhere, or if you live in a smaller, you know, Fresno, California, or some other place, how long until it's ubiquitous and I can't own my own car? That's I don't see that in my lifetime. I'm gonna, maybe in Marty's lifetime. And I'm not giving up the keys. And, you know, so I still drive manual transmission because I can't stand an automatic because I want to have the control, right? So I'm, mm-hmm. I definitely won't be an early adopter here. But I don't see it. I think it's a long, long way to go. And, you know, we're going to be in ham radio 9.0, 10.0 before we get there anyways. And who knows how much it will change and what it will look like by then.
Yeah. I mean, so I don't
can
even
I
think...
change the subject here completely?
Oh, I was gonna say, like, yeah. I agree with Dave. Like, I don't even think it's gonna be a huge impact in our lifetime, even. I think driving, like, cars that you can drive are gonna be here for a very long time, and there's not gonna be any legislation that says, okay, now we're not gonna let anybody drive cars. But when that happens, like, maybe that'll be Marty's lifetime. I don't know. When that happens, ham radio mobile is definitely gonna have like some kind of, you know, battle to face there, and we'll come with it. We'll go with it when it comes. But yeah. I can imagine plopping a mag mount on the roof, but I don't know about, yeah, I don't know about 1500 watt on HF, you know, mobile anymore.
So maybe that devolves to remote operating, because we'll have, you know, plenty of bandwidth.
True. True.
But you know, to me,
Gary, you just said last week fiber was coming into your area.
Fiber went past me.
Went past you.
Flew right by
your front yard. Technical for this old part.
Did not collect $200 from me.
Yeah. Go straight to jail.
The whole idea of MCOM. So maybe in 20 years, if they do really, you know, legislate it, right? And I could see places, look at London, you can't really drive downtown London unless you have some special permit, right? And so if they do legislate it and they do force it, from an MCOM perspective, most of the time when I'm communicating MCOM, I'm at a fixed location, right? Serving some served agency, some location that needs me, some place that's in need. Now, sure, we might put somebody in a fire truck or somebody in a police car to drive around to provide the access to communications because they've lost it, because they think their awesome systems will stand up to anything, and they don't really.
What I'm about to do will be deeply controversial. I'd like to change coming from talking about you bring the bridge over to MCOM, and I'm kind of interested. Besides what's going to happen to MCOM, how is MCOM going to have to evolve? And you just said, I listened to a very interesting presentation this week from Mike Corey, KI1U, who's the head of ARIES at the ARRL, and he made a very interesting point that I'd be interested to hear David's perspective on, because in today's emergency communications world, you know, it's all about partnerships and working together. And I think in social skills, I'm not saying this is you, I'm saying ham radio in general, ham radio attracts a lot of people who don't always have the highest level of social communication skills, etc. Hams, that is. And why are we calling the organizations we work with these days served agencies? And why aren't we calling them communications partners? Because isn't that what they, to me, that's what they are. We seem really antiquated with these big serious terms. You know, it's the guy who puts on his big Aries vest and feels powerful. If he uses this big powerful language, does he suddenly, you know, become more important? Because I don't think served agencies is what Aries is.
Served agencies is not a real old term, is it, David?
I'm 10
years or so. And it didn't originate with us, I don't think.
I know the Aries people at the league denounce it.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know how long it's been in existence. Maybe it's inaccurate. So, you know, and I'll get into jargon and technical terms again. Our mission in Southern California is we work with hospitals. They're our served agency. And we could call them our communications partner, but I'm not sure that's accurate or not. And, you know, it didn't really matter to me. What was the first part of the question? Because I think that was Meteor. And sorry, I kind of got off track.
My question is, how does Aries have to evolve? Aries,
yeah, how does MCOM evolve?
Right. And my follow-up to that was, I feel like we're already kind of antiquated. We missed the boat 20 years ago.
I don't know about that. So MCOM's evolving. Some of the Tapper stuff that Gary put up in the last week or two kind of speaks to that. Some of the changes that are going on, like Arden and the ham broadband, are some of the things that I see getting implemented that are really changing. If you look at your incident command structure and how those, again, your served agency functions and what they want from us as communicators is to provide them more than just being able to pass a piece of paper message. They now want their phone and their laptop to be able to surf the internet or get emails and to be able to send those things. And the way MCOM is evolving is starting to provide those things with tools like, you know, Arden and the ham broadband. We're able to actually get into locations that don't have communications and give the ability to folks to hook up to a private network, and that will eventually downstream somewhere link to the internet so that they can really send email or have a phone conversation or see a map of something or video feed. And, you know, a lot of the stuff that we're doing right now on the ground level, yeah, it's UHF, VHF, you know, passing traffic back and forth. But those things are starting to creep into, and they'll continue to creep into the MCOM world.
Great. Marty, did that answer your question?
I mean, I guess that did, but I'm still not sure. I question, you know, first of all, I think what you guys are doing out in California is very interesting, but I'd be intrigued to see how that kind of, how that, is that the same across the country? Because I feel like it's not. And maybe this is, I don't know, in the MCOM events I've done here locally, it feels a little bit like our role is diminishing. Do you guys have anything to do with anything but anything besides hospitals? Do they no longer want you or need you?
No. So I can only talk about Southern California. In Southern California, there are a number of different amateur aid groups. So ARES and the ARRL are, again, our mission in Southern California is working with hospitals. We are starting to work with law enforcement, fire departments, and other groups as well. But also in the LA area, DCS, the Los Angeles Sheriff Department, has their own dedicated amateur radio group that's called DCS. There is a group that works with Los Angeles County Fire Department, ACS, and they actually go under the State Auxiliary Communication Service. And there are a number of other organizations as well.
So that's more close to RACES.
It's similar, yeah.
Yeah. Those are like the core questions of the show. The MCOM Extra part of Ham Radio Now. Those are things we are exploring every time we do an episode.
Right.
But he's still the big mature kid in the room. So we need to tap his brain a little bit.
Sure.
Yeah. Sterling and Gary play with their cats. I talk about nonsense. He is the smart person stuff.
Well,
I like you guys too. I'm not throwing you guys under the bus.
No, I'm always bringing up where with the MCOM guys we talk to. It's, you know, where is MCOM going in terms of exploring more technology? And the answers I get back, and then the sample size is pretty small right now, is we use 2 meter FM. We're not even using DMR or D-Star yet.
In the other half of the time when I ask why aren't you getting past that, well, they go, you know, the last guy who had my job did it, and why should I change that? Because, you know, if he did it and he worked and he didn't get kicked out,
well,
why should I be changing?
You know, that's sort of the no one ever got fired for recommending IBM argument. But what what I'm getting more of is we can barely get enough people to do our MCOM as it is. And if we start putting stipulations on them that you must have X technology beyond
everybody, beyond has 2 meters.
Everybody's got 2 meter FM. And that
is like the lowest common denominator. And it's really difficult to say, hey, you have to buy into this digital technology. So everybody has to go DMR, or everybody has to go D-Star or System Fusion, or everybody has to go out and buy $100 ubiquity antenna so they can do Arden or this thing or that thing. And it is difficult to do, but you tell everybody you got to show up with an HT that'll do EHF, VHF.
And a half-dead battery.
Program them.
And hopefully
they'll be able to program it, and they'll have more than that one half-dead battery. Most of them will be able to get onto the net and pass the information back and forth that's needed in an emergency. Mm-hmm. Hopefully. Maybe.
So we will keep asking those questions.
Yeah.
And a lot of times,
I feel like we've beat this head, this horse dead, this head.
So I got one more topic I would like to toss out.
Yeah.
We mentioned the phrase ham radio 8.0, and I don't know how many of you guys saw the Sunday seminar from the Tapper Conference that, once again,
that
Bob McGuire.
That's the long one?
Yeah, Bob McGuire and Michelle Thompson put on. I will do my best to summarize what they were talking about, and that is that we are horribly inefficient in our use of spectrum. Not we hams, we the world. Mm-hmm. Everybody is horribly inefficient. Spectrum can easily be reused, and we have the technology to be able to reuse it today. So combine the concept of cognitive radios that can pay attention to their environment and make changes all by themselves with the concept of spectrum reuse, and suddenly you have a whole brave new world of radio where I tell my radio, I need to get a message from Cary, North Carolina to Los Angeles, California. And I need to do it on radio because the internet's gone or whatever. Do it. And it picks the mode and it picks the band and it makes the contact and either sends my file, or if I need to talk to somebody on voice, tactical or whatever, it does that. It's the end of licensing. It's the end of rules. The rules are within the radio. The radio's following its own rules. Where's ham radio in that? Is that a horrible, brave new world? Or is that, because Bob McGuire thought this is kind of a fascinating, brave new world.
Well, it definitely changes things. Like, you won't have, you know, just get on 2 meters. You won't have repeaters. You won't have contesting as we know it right now. It changes basically every single aspect of radio. Yeah. Like, but it could be fascinating. Like, you could get on, I mean, I imagine way in the future when you're, ICOM 94 billion like has this cognitive radio feature where you can plug in
that'll
and say,
be,
I want to
contest. That'll make sense instead of Yaesu confusion and whatnot.
Yeah. It's like, Gary
yells
I don't
at
know.
Me every time I say that.
I don't know if it's going to be like, it's just going to have, you're going to have all of HF spectrum and you're going to have like different modes of like it might even be smart enough to know like how is it propagating from point A to point B. So you could
definitely
be tuning up the band and working like it'll go regionally. Like I want to work stations in the East Coast or in Europe. And so you're tuning through like Europe, Italy, Russia, China. And it's like, I don't know, like it's super fascinating. And the whole idea of cognitive radio, meaning the radio never gets interfered with because it always knows where it's at and who's next to it. It's either networked or it just kind of like spectrum, like analyzes the spectrum and says, okay, there's noise here. Go try something else. And there's already this, like it's called automatic link establishment, and it's not quite
ALE.
And the military uses it and some hams use it where it sends, you have like a list of channels and it sends a sound on every single channel until it finds one where it can hear both of the stations.
Yeah.
So that's basically cognitive radio in a very simple way.
Yeah.
Then imagine networking the radios, imagine like understanding exactly what signals are adjacent and understanding like the propagation of the band. Like what could happen? I don't know. It'll be cool. Like I would love that to be a thing because then people would have no worry about the challenge of communication, but then you lose out. Like we're hams because it's not easy to communicate. It's a challenge. We contest because we know that is competitive. Like some stations, sometimes it's not even station to station. It could be, it's all down to operator skill, which is why WRTC exists. And that just throws a big wrench in it. So I don't know if you'll have like, oh, we want to do legacy mode or whatever.
But. Well, yeah, I'm thinking that ham radio, for current hams, this is something that the hams are going to go, ah, I don't yeah. want to do that.
Yeah.
But hams 20, 30 years from now, or as Bob McGuire was saying, 5 or 10 years from now, could be a totally different thing. I'm thinking of and ham radio has often been considered and compared to national park of spectrum, mm-hmm. where we maintain a spot that ordinary people can go, or ordinary, except that you got to pass the test to get in. But a place where people interested enough in our technology can get in and do all kinds of things and not available in any commercial aspect. I suspect at least for a while, our spectrum will remain the national park of antique communication with some of it set aside to do some of this cool stuff. But, I mean, it sounds cool to anybody who's trying to get the business of communications done.
Yeah.
Because,
you know, yeah. So listen to this talk. You know, I read the article you posted about a week ago, Gary, from 1936 about what ham radio would look like in 2036.
Oh yeah, from the Australian guys.
Yeah, and so you know, it makes me think. You know, my initial reaction is that's probably how, you know, the guy that woke up 100 years later, that's how I would feel about it. Like, this isn't ham radio. I don't know what this is, but it's not. I'm not building anything. I'm not tinkering anything. I'm not having to try very hard. It all just works and plug in, and you hit this and you get your QSL card back. It's not ham radio anymore. And is it right or wrong? I don't know. And, you know, maybe as you said, in 30 or 40 or 50 years, that's what people will expect to see. But someone, I mean, I may not be around, but maybe Marty will look at it and will think to himself, wow, it was ham radio in 2017, but now in 2037, this is just a whole, you know, different animal.
Mm-hmm. Well, I hope to be alive in 2100.
I hope to be alive in 2018.
Yeah. I mean, you're what, 25 now, Gary?
We'll keep our fingers crossed for that.
Yeah. I'm 67. So I'm the oldest guy here, but in my mind, I'm Marty's age.
You know, you could still kick my butt in about everything you do. So
unless we start talking about any kind of technology, you've learned more in a couple of years in ham radio than I have in 51. So
I almost killed his cat the other day.
Uh-oh.
I edited a podcast and put something at the end that was 50 dB louder than the rest of it.
Oh yeah. Yeah. The 73 in Morse code.
Yeah.
Here's a tip for anyone doing podcasts is that any music, any highly bandwidth restricted sounds like sideband all cut through like crazy. So when you're looking at your meters, you want to knock those things down. You don't want your music blip to be as loud as your voice on the meters, because it's going to be way louder because it's more concentrated energy. And so anything you toss in that is, and if you're a ham, you sort of understand this intrinsically. If you don't understand it technically, it's the same filtering deal where if you want to work DX, you put in the narrow filter or you switch on your DX thing in the Heil mic so that, you know, all the low frequencies go away and all the high frequencies go away, and you've just got that middle frequency, and it cuts through a whole lot better.
Except there's that guy who, you know, uses his crappy old mic and sounds like this, you know, and he calls the DX while he's distorting really badly like this.
Yeah, and I don't know why when I was doing that with my filters, I was also doing it with my voice.
But I was. Yeah, you didn't know we had a filter in your face.
Yeah. So why do you call your podcast Phasing Line?
Why do we call the podcast?
Good question. Go for it, Marty. Okay, I'll take it. We don't know. So we were just coming up with a name. We went through a bunch of different ideas, like the delay line, the phasing line, the stack, the quad band, the this and that. Like just something that had a little bit of a ham radio spin to it, but also had a podcast spin. So like something ending in line, like this is a line that we're talking on. I don't know. And then it ended up being kind of, oh, what's that, Marty?
I didn't hear any of this story. It's good to hear from your perspective.
Oh yeah. No, and then I started like writing down a logo, and I noticed that like PL like ended up looking really good if you like move the L just below the P, and it ended up just sticking to it. So at the very couple beginning episodes, we were like, this name might change. It's just something we thought up, and so far it's stuck.
What was the name that I came up with afterwards that we thought was good?
I don't even remember. The Ham Radio 720?
Dead air.
I'm not editing this out for you.
I don't know.
Well, we forget, but it was something.
Not the ham radio show. Something significantly more creative.
We also thought that the ham radio, anything with ham radio, was all taken. We got ham radio, everything.
Ham radio now, ham radio,
ham radio life. Like, and we wanted something different because sometimes we might not even talk about ham radio, but turns out like it's a ham radio podcast.
Are you worried that people aren't going to be able to find it?
No, done fine. And I think the other thing is by having such a unique name, it's a conversation starter. It draws people in.
Yeah.
People don't know what it is. They want to take a listen to figure it out.
And I plop Ham Radio every year. Like our banner says, Ham Radio Podcast. Every show, every tagline, every tag in the thing has Ham Radio. So I'm not too worried about it. And it, again, is like trying to be something a little bit different than what's already out there.
How many hams do you think know what a phasing line is?
I don't think many do, and I think that's great because it gives them something to listen to, and they can learn what a phasing line is. If they know what it is, they're not going to listen about it.
And the name kind of shows its technical side. Like, for a while, I started thinking, is a phasing line even a thing? Isn't it a delay line? Because I Googled what's a phasing line, and it wasn't really clear as to exactly what it is. But basically, what you put in to phase a phased array is what we're calling a phasing line, which is technically a delay line, but whatever.
Yeah, did you know that you've got the term delay line? You do not have a corresponding term advanced line, because you can't do that.
You can't advance
future line.
Yeah, not until we start mastering time.
Mm-hmm. Convolution only works
better. So I didn't know what it was. I'll admit it.
Yeah.
So if you listen to our show, you could probably figure it out.
Yeah, well, I probably have to go Google it again, because I couldn't. I just looked right now. I couldn't even figure it out. I mean, I could, but I didn't try that hard.
It I'm familiar with it in terms of, say, you've got stacked, say, 2 meter beams, you know, 1 8 element.
We beam do it on 40 meters.
Yeah. Over another. Yes. Yeah, some of you do it on 40 meters. More likely to do it on 2 meters. And you have to have those two antennas, the RF that's going to the two gets split from your transmitter, and it's got to be in phase.
Well,
if it's out of phase, if it's 180 degrees out of phase, you're talking to nothing because they cancel each other.
Sometimes you do shift the phase a little bit, or 120 degrees or other various amounts to change the angle of radiation.
Yeah, you wouldn't do that with stacked antennas, but you can do that with verticals. That's what a four-square system
you can do that
does.
With stacks.
If you have enough stacks, you can change the elevation angle.
Yeah,
we do that.
But I do that with two stacks, where sometimes you want to work a really high angle to a person. You can flip in 120 degrees of phase shift to generate a higher angle pattern.
Yeah. So you add a little coax.
Or
change the lengths of the coax from one antenna to the other. And adjust that precisely to put the phase either in phase or out of phase, if that's what you want it to be.
Or somewhere between the two. Yeah.
Is there any other? I mean, within solid state transmitter circuits and stuff, there are phasing lines within.
I mean, there's different phases that have to be matched. And, you know, just any sort of AC application and audio. You know, we always talk about, you know, when you have audio out of phase, you can run into a lot of issues. And
you have two microphones that cancel. You know, he puts two microphones to his mouth, and they cancel out because they're 180 degrees out. Flips a switch, and they like double. So,
and there's, you know, in recording, we run into a lot of issues with phasing and tippering sleeves not wired properly and things like that.
Yeah, but bottom line, like, I try not to bring too much attention to the idea of like what is the name, and I actually I'm kind of curious. It's actually really helpful to know, like, some people, like, what is phasing line, or is this a podcast that might actually interest me? So that's why I try to throw in ham radio everywhere, and all the topics we have is, you know, ham radio related. So it'll hopefully organically evolve into, you know, people knowing that it's a ham radio podcast that young people are on. Now, I wanted to do, like, there's some other podcasts in the mix, and I used to run the Youth and Amateur Radio Podcast, or YARP.
YARP.
And that was some other terms we were thinking of, is like the Youth Ham Radio Podcast.
You can excuse yourself every time you say that. YARP.
YARP. Excuse me.
Yeah, and that eventually fell because it was, like, really scripted. Like a feather on me.
Needless to say, if you haven't figured out yet, I'm a very unscripted person.
Yeah, and we went away from that, and it's way, way better for it. But we also wanted to get away from,
you're not reading,
like,
a script now? Because I sent you one.
Like, you can see the teleprompter, you know, right here, if you're looking at
it. He's, like, typing out the message.
We have the teleprompter here, and, you know, we turn this, and we have, you know, I have my little iPhone reading me all the cues, and Gary says talk, and I talk. And my producer, you see that door back there in the shot? If you open that door, my little producer sits in the closet, and she takes live feedback from everybody. And I have the green screen right here. The chroma key actually looks quite nice today.
My producer's right there.
Yeah.
You can see Justin in the couch over there.
And you can see Gary's mixer down below. It's keyed in very nicely in that green booth. The blue screen.
I've lost my micro cam.
Yeah.
It's just,
no, there's the blue screen that's not keying properly.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I just discovered something I could do with Skype here. I can I promote one person to a full screen. I thought the only thing I could do is take you back to three screens, but
you can
do
a two screen too.
Yeah. Cool.
Neat.
Yeah. TIL. Yeah. But yeah, like, but I don't know. Like, we're also, like, I'm also working with some people in Marty, and it's kind of already out there. There's another podcast called The Noisy Key, which is, I think, even a cooler name, but it's going to be like a youth roundtable, and we're still trying to get everybody together at once to do shows on that.
Noisy key makes no sense.
Well, think of it this way. Think of it in terms of a silent key is a ham who is no longer alive. And we are noisy keys. We are very lively hams because we're young. So that's, I think, their...
Now I understand.
That reminds me of, what is it, 78?
You actually, I was with Gary. It didn't work. And now you actually kind of pulled it back together there.
Yeah. So you pulled that one out of the fire. Nice job.
I don't. There's all these... There's all these strange, you know, 78s and 73 and 88s and all those ways of saying goodbye, all the ways of saying whatever you want to say. And I think that's kind of, you know, the secret code of ham radio. But on the subject of bye-bye, it's been great to kind of do this with you, but I think it's getting late.
It's bedtime.
It's been a lot of fun.
It's 9:11. It's not your bedtime. You stay up until 2.
How do you know that?
It's my bedtime.
Because I find you on Skype.
Yeah, I think it's time for me to barbecue, so it's good too for me. But we should definitely do this again.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Yeah, it's been fun.
This is the phasing radio now line.
The question is, which one of our closing lines gets used in which show? You don't have a standard closing, do you? You just kind of fall apart.
It's typically bye-bye.
Da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da.
Or we do the bye-bye for now is my classic line. But I guess, you know, before we do the wrap-up, if you like this, you might want to give both of us money so we both do more of this.
Okay, so you guys are here.
PhasingLinePodcast.com, and there's a link to Patreon. But you can just go to Patreon.com.
Let's see if we've picked up...
PhasingLine Podcast.
Let's see if we've picked up anybody on your Patreon.
Facebook? Oh, Patreon. Real-time.
Yeah, you had three
Somebody's
and you
a
got
new,
four.
A new patron.
Yeah.
There you go.
Thank you, Gary. This worked.
We pulled somebody out of Facebook Live.
Yeah, that's cool.
So,
I'm not sure how we magically edit that in video to look like it happened.
So pretty awesome. Or hamradionow.tv and...
Beat Arvin.
Arvin will be your conductor to the contribution page.
But look how full Arvin is compared to how empty Marvin is. What are we going to call him? I don't know. He could use some food, I think. So give Marvin some food. He doesn't exist. He's not an animal.
You need a mascot.
A mascot. Yep.
Yep.
We are going to... I think I have a phasing line here.
A piece of coax? We'll just put a piece of coax. Feed the coax or something. Feed the coax. Get it?
Feed the coax.
Feed the coax on the phasing line?
Feed my coax into my saltwater dummy load.
Yeah.
I don't know what it'll do, but your efforts will go into heating up the water.
Yeah.
Patreon.com/phasingline podcast. Patreon.com/ham radio now. Give us some love. Keep watching both of us. Ham Radio Now on YouTube. Just listen to our RSS feed. And I guess I am over.
And out.
They used it all up, David. There's nothing left for you and me.
Yeah.
I thought we were going to say over and you guys were going to say out.
No,
let's
but
try
I think
this again.
I think everybody's got to reintroduce themselves one more time,
okay,
too.
Okay, yeah. I'm Marty, KC1CWF.
And I'm Sterling in 0SSC.
And I'm David, W0DHG.
And I am Gary, KN4AQ. Let's all do it together.
Together.
Everything. Three, together. Two, one. Over.
Over.
And out.
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 That was terrible.